Marbles, statues, and columns crossed the Mediterranean for centuries. Many ships never arrived at their destinations. Under the waves of the sea lies an immense museum. The water is the guardian of innumerable examples of a material left behind by cosmic events that preceded the appearance of man on Earth. Past civilizations considered the marble among the most precious of substances and left us sarcophagi, unworked blocks, columns, and marble carvings destined for villas, temples, and public buildings. These marvelous works by ancient sculptors went to the bottom of the sea, together with the ships that carried them. The sea has swallowed up entire cities, with their houses, their streets, and their statues. Extraordinary discoveries lie in wait for underwater archaeologists, investigators intent on the task of reconstructing pieces of a forgotten history. These treasures in stone, buried in the sea, indications of ancient ties between East and West, are strewn in the wakes of the earliest Mediterranean shipping routes. At the southern tip of the Italian peninsula, the coasts of Apulia face the Ionian Sea, exposed to the winds that blow from the south. From the bottom of a clear sea, but one capable of becoming impetuous, there appear in front of us the remains of a ship used for transporting marble. In the period of the greatest splendor of Imperial Rome, these vessels reached remarkable dimensions. The imposing load of marble blocks rests on the sandy seabed at a depth of a mere 5 meters. Archaeologists investigating this zone have counted 24 sarcophagi of large grained white marble whose carving is only roughly sketched out. The most highly prized material for the construction of sarcophagi was not the common Lunense marble, so called from being quarried at ancient Luni, now modern-day Carrara, but the type that was transported from Greece and Asia Minor on long sea voyages and therefore known as transmarinus, across the sea. Where the waves lifted the sand from the seafloor, the marble shows all its luster. Covered by a light stratum of sediment, it seems to have been spared from the corrosion of the sea. The hull of the shipwrecked vessel came to a different fate. During the course of the centuries, it's completely dissolved in the sea. Perhaps some wooden parts still lie under the mantle of sand. Spectacles such as this are highly evocative. The myth of Atlantis, the voyage of Jason and the Argonauts, the lays of ancient minstrels, all memories of a time when this sea was still inhabited by gods. The sarcophagi seem still to be placed according to their original arrangement on the ship. Some oval-shaped pieces are placed inside others of larger dimensions. This arrangement was intended to make the best use of the space available inside the ship. A small, oval sarcophagus sticks out of the sand. It was probably destined for the burial of a child. The composition of the load according to an authoritative opinion, implies the existence of a traffic in standard-sized marble pieces intended to be finished off at their destination, according to the requirements of the clients. Some rectangular sarcophagi, united by twos in the same block of marble, recall the burial of a married couple. Were these pieces meant to be separated or simply finished off? And why is there no trace of slabs to be used as covers? In one block, there's the bare outline of a tub. To one side, enough material has been left to allow refined elaboration. The exterior projections, left unfinished, facilitated the transportation of the marble pieces, each one weighing tens of tons. In the finishing off process, artisans would transform them into lions' heads or other decorations. The ship was about to try to pass the Straits of Messina and then continue its route toward Rome, or perhaps her destination was Taranto, well known for its workshops of stonecutters specializing in fine wrought embellishments. This second hypothesis is supported by the presence of numerous shipwrecks of marble-carrying vessels in the entire zone of the shallows that extends between the cities of Taranto and Santa Maria de Leuca, the coastal trading routes that connected Rome and Tyrrhenian Italy with the eastern provinces. This ship probably sank in the 2nd century BC. Did its precious cargo come from some Greek island, or even from magnificent faraway Aphrodisias? We sail eastwards, retracing the ancient route of the maritime traffic in marble. We leave the Ionian coasts of Apulia, and on the opposite side of the Mediterranean we reach the heart of Asia Minor, modern-day Turkey. We're in the countryside of Hierapolis, the sacred city, not far from the glorious vestiges of Aphrodisias. Appearing before us is the magical image of the largest and best conserved necropolis in the entire ancient world. Thousands of tombs and sarcophagi give us information on the life of a city of more than 100,000 inhabitants, a center that was considered one of the richest in the Roman Empire. The tombs of the common people are small sarcophagi, buried or simply placed on the ground. Inscriptions berate violators of the sarcophagi, give the names of their owners and their profession, and list the most important events in their lives. Family tombs are very large. The sarcophagi of the rich, of dignitaries, and of heroes are monumental. Occasionally, an epitaph proclaims the greatness of the city or the power of the Roman Senate.
The sacred power of Apollo guides us.
The most famous and glorious people. Hail, powerful city, who preserves in your breast the most grandiose of monuments. Hail to you, who have won the respect of the great peoples.
In Hierapolis, the marbles of Roman times cover the traces of the passage of more ancient people, Hittites, Lydians, Phrygians, and Lycians. But why did this land cast such a spell of irresistible attraction on the civilizations of the past? The era that preceded the founding of the city is wrapped in mystery, but we do know that in remotest times, temples were built to worship an extraordinary phenomenon. Indeed, in this region of Anatolia, a true marvel of nature is made manifest and still today stimulates the imagination of the local population. Its modern name, Pamukkale, means castle of cotton. The ancient writer, Smyrneo, tells us a legend that relates to the origin of these places.
The handsome shepherd Endymion was grazing his flock in the hills of Hierapolis. The image of his beauty went far and wide. When he fell asleep amidst his flock, Selene, goddess of the moon, came down next to him. Because of his great joy at being with her, He forgot to milk his goats, and their milk flowed everywhere in great quantity.
The pools of Hierapolis form wide descending terraces, a succession of semicircular bodies of water decorated with stalactites. Whether they're made of petrified milk, or according to another legend, are stacks of cotton put out to dry by giants, the terraces, shaped by the calcium-rich folds that run down the flanks of the nearby hill, made the fame of Hierapolis unique, the city of the waters. The sediment covered the ruins of the city with a hard layer. Vitruvius explains.
At Hierapolis in Phrygia exists a spring whose water has the temperature of the human body. In it is an element which, in contact with the air and the heat of the sun, becomes as hard as sea salt.
The Romans built fountains, baths, and centers for medicinal cures around the springs. These ruins were once porticos, architraves, altars, water lily ponds, gymnasiums, and shops for food and drink. The baths, decorated with precious marble, were one of the symbols of their culture. Cassiodorus wrote to the emperor Atalaric.
There are hot baths, heated not by brick conduits or by smoking furnaces, but directly by nature.
Even in antiquity, man was happy when he felt himself clean and spruced up. The baths in the great thermal establishments were the principal activities of daily life. The ancients compared them to the joys of wine and love. In Rome, only the most luxurious villas had private baths. In Hierapolis, on the other hand, there were baths in practically all the houses, thanks to a distribution network that carried the precious mineral water. To be truly in fine fettle, a bather could not do without unguents and soda in place of soap, which did not yet exist. Pliny gives us a recipe of Persian origin for a perfume composed of honey, wine, and 25 further ingredients. Scientists of the time praised the therapeutic qualities of the baths, but attributed their benefits to a magical power of transformation. The springs took on a mystical character. It was believed that the cures affected by the water were due to the favorable interventions of the gods, Apollo, Hercules, Aesculapius, and Aegea. From an opening in the ground, called the plutonium, came forth a deadly gas which expanded in the form of a dense layer of fog. The Forum of Pluto, god of the shadows and of evil, was consecrated to the cult of the invisible and to the voices of mystery. This dangerous area was surrounded by a barrier. Only the black eunuchs of the harem could approach it. Strabonus moved some sparrows into the area. They all died immediately. Along with hypnosis and prayers to the divinity of the underworld, the priests of the goddess Cybele cured the sick by making use of the exhalations of that poisonous gas sent by evil spirits. Seneca recounts.
How many statues, how many columns supporting nothing have been put there as mere ornaments? Round mirrors, spouts of silver, Alexandrine marble must alternate with the Numidian and the white marble of Thasos. We now consider rat holes any bathing hall where the sun does not shine through the windows for the entire day, and where we cannot enjoy a panoramic view of the countryside and the sea. We have come to such a point that we no longer wish to walk if we are not trampling gems and precious stones underfoot.
The sacred road of Hierapolis, 14 meters wide, was adorned with columns and statues created by artists from the nearby city of Aphrodisias. In the time of the Emperor Hadrian, one of the largest amphitheaters in Asia was built, using in part the marble of an even older theater. In it, 15,000 people could watch the comedies and the tragedies. The superb statues and reliefs that adorned its famous stage have disappeared. Some of the most precious marbles, those that survived pillage and earthquakes, wound up in the museums of Rome, London, and Berlin. A like destiny was in store for Aphrodisias, the city of the goddess of beauty, who was born from the waves of the sea. Through the same tragic irony of history, only ruins are left to bear witness to the greatness of a level of art never before achieved by mankind. Aphrodisias was a center for the study of medicine, astronomy, and mathematics. But above all, for many centuries, it was the site of a school and a permanent exhibition of sculpture that received the legacy of the highest art of classical Greece. It was the only place in the ancient world where true contests of sculpture were held. Artists vied with each other to make life pulsate in the material, thanks to their gift for expression and a profound knowledge of anatomy. Hundreds of statues and columns were carried by sea to far-off destinations, especially the capital of the empire. The very statue of Aphrodite was lost when the ship carrying it went down. Perhaps she's waiting in nearby waters to be freed from her undersea grave and to be restored to the temple that honored her. Prized marbles veined with white, gray, and blue were carefully selected from the mountains near the city. Others were extracted from the quarries in the Greek islands of Thassos, Patmos, Paros, and in other locations on the eastern coast of Asia Minor, and northwards up to the Black Sea and the island of Marmara in the sea of the same name, which is derived from the word marble. At the extremities of sections of columns and other architectural components, special holes and cavities of various shapes were cut into the stone. They allowed the insertion of metal rods and clamps. The trunks of the larger columns were not always honed from a single piece of marble. For their construction, a technique was often adopted whereby the column was made up of sections, called drums, of unfinished hunks of marble and barely sketched in blocks. Once at their destination, the marble drums were carved and fluted and then piled one on top of the other, becoming a single admirable column. Generations of artists in Aphrodisias competed in looking for new motifs and ever different marble decorations. A modern marble quarry in the mountains of Carrara, a luminous natural amphitheater. And these are the remains of a quarry that dates back to Roman times. Parts of columns, capitals, and other incompletely worked architectural elements are still waiting for an unlikely embarkation on a marble-carrying ship. In antiquity, nearness to the sea was an essential condition for exploiting a quarry. The sea voyage made the trip easier. Road transportation of just a single drum of an average column would have required 30 pairs of oxen. For the extraction, wedges of wood were inserted in small cavities made with hammer and chisel along a dotted line that defined the breaking point. The wedges were sprinkled with water and covered with wet rags. The expanding wood provoked the detaching of the block of stone. Technology has greatly modified the strenuous job of the quarry worker. Only a few fragments remain today of the sacred road that began at Hierapolis and extended for dozens of kilometers. The marble slabs that mantled it were sometimes considered more precious than the parts with mosaics. The road led to the most important cities and religious centers of the area. Mileto, son of the god Apollo, gave his name to the capital of the region, which in the Old Testament was called Yavan, the cradle of Ionian civilization. The first excavations cast a ray of light on the glorious past of the city. Perhaps it was from here that the Etruscans began their voyage to Italy, there to introduce their culture. The Phoenician alphabet of 23 characters spread to Mileto and other Ionian cities. Phileta elaborated his geometry and astronomy there, accurately predicting the solar eclipse of May 28th, 585 BC. The sacred road led to Ephesus, which an ancient inscription defines as the first and greatest metropolis of Asia. The magnificent library was a famed center of culture and thought. The temple of Artemis, now lost, was so grandiose as to be numbered among the seven wonders of the ancient world. These marbles, these columns, were witnesses to the flowering of the oldest Mediterranean cultures. Today, we walk down the sacred road, just as Hittites, Phoenicians, Greeks, Romans, Byzantines, and Ottomans did for centuries. In the sculptures of Aphrodisias, we can make out the faces of the men and women who preceded us. Cicero wrote to his friend Atticus,
"I'm eager to see the statues you wrote to me about. Send me whatever you find that seems fitting for my villa. Spare no expense."
The Romans, after conquering the cities of Greece and Asia Minor, were in their turn conquered by the ideals of beauty and sentiment that had inspired those ancient masters. From Mileto, the long marble road led to Didyme. From the quarries of the Greek island of Patmos were chosen the finest marbles to be used in constructing the imposing columns of the Temple of Apollo. Considered in the Greek world as the god of oracles, Apollo made his appearance in Anatolia with the name of Aplunas. This is attested to by Hittite inscriptions that go back to the 7th millennium before the birth of Christ. Detailed reports describe the extremely costly task of the construction of the temple. Revelations from the oracles and prayers addressed to the divinities of the sea favored voyages across the Mediterranean. In a very remote time, this area was called Lycia. The memory of this ancient people vanishes between history and legend. The coast from Kos to Phetia was the center of Lycia. We move toward the extreme south of Turkey. Many places can only be visited from the sea. The stone tombs that bring to mind the form of a house transmit an arcane message from the past, the last image of a people whose origins are extremely ancient. The world of the Lycians still preserves a great part of its mystery. Their cities are shrouded in the mists of antiquity. Dozens of tombs were discovered on the rocky promontories. The sad peace of this city of the dead is relieved by the breeze from the sea. Where did this people come from? And when did they settle in this land? We know from the Iliad that the Lycians lived in the region during the second millennium before Christ, and they went to give aid to Troy. The invasion of the Persians in 546 BC signaled the end of their civilization. The heroic resistance of the Lycians ended in a tragic episode. The inhabitants of Xanthos united in mass suicide.
"We chose to give up our lives for the honor of our women and our dead. We have transformed our houses into tombs and our tombs into houses. The houses have been destroyed, the tombs pillaged. We have buried ourselves underground. We have hidden at the bottom of the sea. They came, they found us, and they destroyed us."
Our ship is now alongside the island of Kekova. The peninsula that sticks out toward the island of Castellorizzo encloses the vast bay of Simene, designing an inlet that is a large natural port. Lycian necropolises are perched on sea cliffs where once wild boars, deer, and goats were hunted. The sarcophagi that belonged to the most important families were decorated with statues and rich sculptures in low relief, which are now lost. Some tombs are carved directly out of the rocks. Perhaps the Lycian artisans were actually the Cyclops. This sea was the site of intense maritime traffic and the crossing point of the ancient commercial routes from Anatolia toward Egypt and Rhodes. This inlet was a port of call, specializing in the marble trade. The ships approached the small archipelago that faced the city of Simene in order to take aboard blocks of stone and marble. These cliffs were for centuries quarry islands, involuntary sculptures modeled by the quarry workers. The steps and the banks dug directly into the rock still show signs of ancient scalpels. We reach a little island destined for a particular function, fish farming. The wharves that allowed the ships to tie up and the large pool for maintaining the fish were cut into the same rock, still today semi-submerged by the surf. Nearness to sea level made it easy to keep the pool supplied with fresh seawater. The skeleton of an ancient house of stone and marble arises from sea level. A millstone is still in its place in the courtyard. Alongside the island of Kekova, movements of the earth have caused a lowering of the coastline. The foundations of the house go all the way down to the sea. Let's explore the seabed in front of it. Here we found another small millstone. The quality of the stone indicated how long it would last and how well it would function, preventing, according to ancient sources, the stone from splintering and getting mixed up in the grain. This marble floor was walked upon by the men and women of 3,000 years ago. We sail past an entirely submerged wall. The phenomenon of upheavals and movements of the earth was already known to Seneca.
It is well to bear in mind that the gods have nothing to do with these occurrences, and the convulsions of the earth are not due to the anger of the divinities.
These places are rich in history, both above and below the surface of the sea. We can clearly distinguish the structures and ruins of ancient constructions resting on the seafloor. We're swimming through the ruins of a submerged city. Buildings, foundations, streets, and man-made objects, everything has been brought under the waves. Kekova, the ancient city of the Lycians, has gradually slipped down into the sea, as if trying to hide from her enemies. We're now near the center of the sunken city. The imprint of the ancient houses remains on the rock walls. Their profiles are designed around the cavities in which wooden poles were inserted for structural support. Many other houses along the coast were cut in half by the sea or were completely submerged. Their structures are barely visible among the reflections of the waves. The movements of the water seem to evoke the living city itself. One day, it might be possible to reconstruct the topography of the city. Kekova went down with its port and its ships, its houses and objects, its perfumes, and the glimmer of its marbles and bronzes. After 2,000 years, all is still submerged. Diving in these waters is placed under severe restrictions, since these underwater sites have not yet been examined by archaeologists. We gather a team that includes Haluk Çıkan, one of the most famous divers in Turkey. We prepare our descent aboard a boat that is as well equipped as it is picturesque. A Turkish TV crew is with us. We're about to visit the most extraordinary of undersea museums. The reign of underwater archaeology begins. Suddenly, we're aware of scenes from life in a far-off time. Soon, there appear before us amphorae, symbols of ancient commerce, recalled also in depictions on low-relief marble. The seabed is covered with vases, plates, lamps, cups, and fragments of terracotta. Their various forms and places of origin underline the passing, in this place, of the most ancient Mediterranean civilizations. Precious objects, lying next to others for common use, things from everyday life, put us in contact with lost origins. In waters not too far away lie the remains of the oldest shipwrecks known in the Mediterranean. Their discovery heralded the birth of underwater archaeology. The diver is privileged. He comes into contact with a different world where every discovery is deeply thrilling. In the silence of this sea, at a depth of only a few dozens of meters, we see the lights of a city that disappeared under the waves. The Aegean Sea has always encouraged sailors to adventure, enclosed as it is by three continents and dotted with innumerable islands. Delos, the ideal bridge between Rome and the Orient, was the island sacred to the sun god Apollo and the site of his oracle. But for the last 2,000 years, the only inhabitants have been the stone lions that look to the east where Apollo's shining disc rises. Covered in precious marbles and always wrapped in the light of the sun, Delos appeared even from far off extraordinarily white and luminous. In 425 BC, the Athenians attributed an epidemic of the plague to Apollo's wrath. In order to purify the island consecrated to the god, from that moment on, the inhabitants were forbidden to bury their dead there, and the women had to go elsewhere to give birth. On Delos, it was forbidden to be born or to die. Delos became the most important island of the ancient world. From Milos to Paros, from Naxos to Santorini, the Cyclades owe their name to the fact that they are arranged in a semicircle around the island sacred to the sun god. The fountain of Minossi, a public water source, and the river Inopo were sung by Homer. We enter the living room of one of the houses. Here's the dining table. Homer himself explains that the cuisine was based on fish, roasted meats, and milk products. Many houses are uncovered because during the course of the centuries, people from nearby islands organized regular expeditions to gather pieces of marble for their own houses. Hercules' home is a rare example of an ancient three-storied house that has survived down to modern times. The ruins of Delos evoke the time of power and wealth when this little rock in the Aegean was the center of the known world. We might never know whether these remains of shipwrecks indicate ancient commerce, or, on the other hand, if they go back to voyages made many centuries later in reverse, when the marbles of Delos were taken away to distant countries as the booty of pillaging or utilized for construction on nearby islands. Only 1 mile away is Mykonos. According to legend, Delos, so that it would always be accessible to men, was attached to Mykonos by a chain. In AD 1200, when the Venetians arrived, as new dominators of the island, they built their own residential zone, a row of houses with protruding balconies that allowed a direct contact with the ships and the sea. The traditional architecture of Mykonos has its origin in that of Delos. Among the cubes of its houses wind narrow and sinuous streets, the legacy of a far-off past. The masons of Mykonos took the marbles of Delos away to use in construction or even to be ground down for lime. The dimensions of the houses, the width of the streets, all the structural design of the glorious deserted city inspired the architects of Mykonos. In 67 BC, Nero ordered the Channel of Corinth to be dug. It took until 1893 to complete it, still faithfully following the original detailed project plans. Before that time, ships heading west had to drop down south of the Peloponnesus. The fortress of Mitone was built in the Middle Ages in order to protect the Venetian ships that came to load up on silks. The ancient name of the peninsula was Morea for the great quantity of mulberry trees that grew there and allowed the precious fiber to be produced. At a slight depth, at the foot of the cliff, appear a number of granite columns. There's no trace of the ship that carried them. Perhaps it's a very ancient shipwreck, or perhaps the violence of heavy seas pushed the remains of the ship far away from the point where the load was lost. The weight of this shipment has been calculated at 132 tons. It could be carried safely by a ship 30 or 40 meters long. We know from the Iliad that Mitone was one of the cities that Agamemnon offered to Hercules in the hope of placating his anger. The reign of Nestor was the most important in the Peloponnesus after that of Agamemnon, and his magnificent palace arose in Pylos, only a few kilometers from Mitone. Perhaps these enormous columns were destined for Nestor's fabled palace. Ancient depictions praise the splendor of the palace, rich with statues and columns, decorated splendidly in gold, ivory, and marble, much like the Minoan palaces. They remind us that in those times men often painted their works, even those of marble. But it seems more likely that the columns, like the ones found at the Mitone Castle, date from Byzantine times, or else from the latest period of the Roman Empire. The Peloponnesus Peninsula was an obligatory stopping point for ships that were along the coast, waiting for the favorable moment to set sail for Italy. But before the Channel of Corinth was completed, this was also the seafaring route to Delphi. The world's spiritual reference point for over 2,000 years, the Oracle of Apollo predicted the destinies of nations and kings, soldiers and simple pilgrims. The priestess entered a trance by chewing bay leaves, the tree sacred to Apollo, and emitted the responses in verses difficult to understand up until the day when she predicted her own death. Before the Christian emperor Theodosius ordered the great sanctuary destroyed in AD 390, the oracle sang.
The temple of Apollo is fallen, ruined are the lovely courtyards. Phoebus has no more dwelling, nor foretelling laurel, nor speaking stream. Even the prophetic water is silenced.
Along the sacred road were niches where the Greek cities left their offerings to the god, as the Athenians did to celebrate the victory over the Persians at Marathon. Among the bronze statues, perhaps the bronzes of Riace had a place here before they were shipped towards Rome. Finding a lost work of art under the sea is one of the most thrilling discoveries a diver can make. At the beginning of this century, a small Greek boat returning from a sponge-seeking expedition off the North African coast took refuge from a storm by dropping anchor in an inlet on Antikythera, halfway between the Peloponnesus and Crete. A diver went down, hoping to profit from the enforced layover, but instead of sponges, he found an extraordinary spectacle waiting for him. Heads, arms, legs of bronze and marble belonging to a great number of statues were sticking out of the seafloor, half buried in the sand. Subsequent research led to the recovery of a whole load of exquisitely wrought statues, some of which became famous, such as the philosopher and the adolescent of Antikythera, as well as 36 other statues, 4 marble horses, and a great number of fragments of sculptures of large dimensions. For ships traveling from the Aegean Sea to the Ionian,
The arm of the sea that separates the island of Sapienza from the extreme southern tip of the Peloponnesus is an obligatory point of passage, today as it was 2,000 years ago. These luminous waters were the site for another drama of the sea in olden times. The relative shallowness allows us to explore the zone without tanks. Here are four sarcophagi, slightly greenish from a thin layer of marine vegetation. The garlands in relief on the sides are only outlined. Once at their destination, a sculptor would have finished off the details of the petals and leaves, and perhaps would have added an inscription. In the shipwreck, the lids wound up on the seabed. This was a real and true commerce of prefabricated marble works 2,000 years ago. This cargo must have been very precious for whoever was waiting for it. In vain. The sarcophagi are engraved in a material to which the ancients attributed supernatural qualities, a volcanic stone from Assos in the region of the Troad. This stone, according to Pliny the Elder, was able to consume the body of the deceased in only 40 days. This opinion must have been quite widespread, since the name of this stone, with the macabre virtue lapis sarcophagus, literally stone that devours flesh, was used both in Latin and in Greek as a name for the characteristic coffins in stone or marble, sarcophagi, throughout the entire ancient world. We set sail again, following the route that perhaps was used by the ship that was wrecked off this small island south of the Peloponnesus. Not all the ships that traveled this ancient marble route toward the Italian Sea were making for Rome. Shipwrecks in great numbers have been discovered off the southern coast of Sicily. The Gulf of Taormina is the background for the stage of the ancient theatre. When the Greeks established their colonies, they intended to create monuments, temples, and theatres as splendid as those in the homeland. On the surrounding seabed, a team of underwater researchers are carrying out a systematic exploration. Their efforts are directed at creating an accurate map of the sunken ships and other discoveries, the first ever made in these submerged zones. In the first campaign of underwater excavations in the 60s, archaeologists would very rarely dive. They would simply sit in their boats and oversee the work of the divers, following the trail of air bubbles. Today, archaeologists are skilled in diving and participate directly in the work carried out in the depths. On seafloors such as this, the piling up of sand begins at the very moment of the wreck. A special, powerful suction tube is employed in order to free buried objects. Its function is based on the simple depression created by a blast of air, which is forced into the lowest end of the tube and then tends to rise upwards. Here's one of the first results of the research, a marble fragment covered with incrustations, perhaps part of an architrave. Every discovery can offer a worthwhile contribution to knowledge. The excavations continue on the site where a large lead anchor was found. It will shortly be freed from the sand. While the work goes on, we explore several sites within the zone of research. An area of seabed that extends for approximately 4 kilometers between the coast and the open sea. The currents in the Strait of Messina can transform the sea into a gigantic, turbulent river. 27 meters down, we're at the point where the voyage of a load of marble blocks and columns was interrupted forever. These marbles, which were probably destined for a temple, now offer shelter to a population of feather duster worms and serpent stars, marine creatures of bizarre appearances. Here, animals may be confused with plants. There are flowers with mouths and worms and crustaceans that live permanently clamped to the seabed. Meanwhile, in the underwater workyard, the leaden fluke of a great Roman anchor has been almost entirely removed from the sand, and intense preparations are being made to bring it to the surface. Even an object as unremarkable as an anchor can furnish precious data, such as the position of the wreck on the seafloor and the dimensions of the ship. Sometimes it can even point out the very existence of a vessel. Not very far from the working zone, we come across two imposing columns. Even though they're almost completely worn down by corrosion, we can still make out the tracery of a delicate spiral pattern. The anchor by now has been tied to a large air bladder which is able to lift it up to the surface. Under the sea, the archaeologists cannot use shovels or picks, not even a winch. Their instruments are the suction pipe and the air bladder. All that is needed to make them work is, indeed, simple air. The air bladder is the freight elevator of underwater archaeologists. Our voyage along the traditional marble trade routes comes to its last goal, the ancient port of Rome. Tacitus writes,
"The lives of the people of Rome are completely dependent upon what comes from the sea, from the Aegean, from Africa, and from Egypt."
The city itself was born thanks to the presence of the river. The Tiber permitted a privileged connection with the Mediterranean, performing the functions of a broad highway to and from the sea. In the era when Rome became the capital of an empire and the center of all trade routes, it had a population of over 2 million. The entire river assumed the appearance of a port, wharves for mooring and zones of wet docks built to counteract the action of the current. A world whose traces have all been lost. But unexpectedly, an imposing complex of wharves was found. They were disposed on three levels that had direct contact with long lines of warehouses. On the left bank of the Tiber, near the present-day Testaccio district, they're bringing to light what remains of the grandiose river port of ancient Rome. The Tiber is a river of a torrential character. Structures for mooring had to be devised on different levels corresponding to its seasonal variations. The remains of the Marmorata quay have been discovered. It was at the same time a mooring place, a warehouse, and an emporium, all dealing with marble. The large quantity of coins found in some of the rooms revealed the presence of the Port Authority's offices. We can imagine a maritime port of call bustling with life. Stevedores unloading merchandise, fishermen and travelers taking refreshment at the local inn, sailors playing dice. What possibilities of mooring were there for a ship coming into Rome's waters? The river was navigable, but not for ships beyond a certain size. At the mouth of the Tiber was one of the greatest ports of antiquity. At the time of the Emperor Trajan, it could provide harbor for 350 large ships. Here, the merchandise was transferred onto barges of limited draft. Hauled by oxen, these vessels took 3 days to make the 24 kilometers that separated the mouth of the Tiber from the Marmorata Emporium. Many marble objects intended for Rome, lost either in a shipwreck or during the unloading process, are still hidden under the riverbed. Some were swept away by disastrous floods. For the greater part of the year, visibility is limited to a few dozens of kilometers, and the heavy pollution makes diving dangerous. Research is also rendered difficult by the fact that with time, the Tiber has changed its course. Some ships transported enormous obelisks. Ancient authors describe the intentional sinking of a marble-carrying ship that had been laid up. It was the ship that Caligula had sent to Egypt with orders to bring back the great obelisk that still dominates St. Peter's Square today. A bit seaward from the mouth of the Tiber were found the remains of the hull. After being filled with tufa stone and volcanic rock, it served as a base for the great lighthouse that signaled the entrance to the port of Ostia. Trajan's column was built of 19 marble drums. 42 meters high, it's one of the great sculptural masterpieces of all time. On the shaft is carved a winding low relief 200 meters long, which in 2,500 sculpted figures illustrates the story of the war against the Dacians. Hollow inside, it's traversed by a spiral staircase that's still usable today and that leads to the top of the monument. The first shiploads of marble came to Rome in the 2nd century BC. At the beginning, it was considered an example of excessive luxury. In the imperial era, the diffusion of marble in construction in Rome was such that the whole city was white with it and blindingly glaring in sunlight. The most prized marbles were sought in quarries spread along the Mediterranean coast, from North Africa to the Sea of Marmara. In one case, an incredible distance was covered. There exists proof of a shipment of marble from the island of Taprobane, present-day Sri Lanka. Marble shared in the fortunes and the decline of Rome. With the spread of Christianity, some pagan temples were preserved as works of art, like the Church of San Lorenzo in Miranda, built inside the vestibule of the Temple of Antoninus and Faustina in the Roman Forum. After centuries of destruction, it's been calculated that some 8,000 columns survive in Rome today, as well as innumerable sculptures, sarcophagi, and architectural decorations. If the marble trade routes had not existed, then neither would many art treasures of inestimable value. Along these routes, precious evidence of classical civilizations have come out of the sea and into the light. Before they were discovered, many of these fragments of history belonged to the world of mythology. Legend has been transformed into reality, restoring to us segments from the lives of the most ancient of Mediterranean peoples.